Thank you for tuning in to Upon the Rock broadcast. I'm your host, Pastor Lawrence Shakir. I believe the Word of God will build a godly foundation in the lives of people. There is more available information on our website. You can log on to shakirministries.org. Now, let's go on to today's message.
So we are going to move forward in the Word today, and I have a teaching, a series that I want to start. It's basically talking about dreams. How many of you all have a dream? You have something that God has spoken to you. You have something that you want to do. Not something you just go to sleep and say, oh, I had a dream. No, I mean, you have a real God-given dream that you're supposed to be doing something great. How many dreamers I have in here? So that's good. Everybody here is a dreamer. Well, my goal is to help you walk in that dream. And I believe God gave me something that's going to assist in that. Okay, you all ready? So today the teaching I got is called The Dreamer. And I'm going to play some little music while I teach a little bit. Is that okay? Because I want you all to kind of see exactly what I'm talking about. Because a lot of times we have dreams and we have this giddy feeling of, oh, I'm going to do this, I'm going to do that, and God's going to bless me. And you have a dream and it sounds good, but then one day you kind of almost wake up and you're like, this is not what I dreamed about. I thought I saw it like this. And so we go through life kind of skipping with a big smile on our face because we know we have a dream. How many dreams do I have in here? So you have this dream, and how come everybody's dream is not fulfilled? Well, the Bible talks about right here that in Ecclesiastes chapter 5, verse 3, it says a dream comes when there are many cares. Everybody say, a dream comes when there are many cares. In other words, and then I'm going to go right here. It says, and many words mark the speech of a fool. So you have two scenarios here. When there's a lot of words going on, a fool is somewhere in that place. If there's a lot of cares, then the Bible says a dream comes. Everybody say, a dream comes. So in other words, this, you have this dream that God has given you. But if you don't surround it with care, if you don't go after it with effort, if you don't place it in an area where it can incubate and learn and grow and be fed, that dream will not come true. Now, according to the Bible, you have to surround it with cares. You can't just say, I had a dream, wake up all happy and say, I'm going to do this. If you don't surround it with, everybody say care. If you don't surround it with care, that would be just a dream. And that's what I think a lot of people go through life because they said, I had a dream. How come it's not working? Maybe you didn't surround it with care. The Bible says a dream. Now, this is the word. A dream comes when there are many cares. So in other words, the dream that you have right now, have you cared for it enough? Did you place something around it? Or did you just kind of just say, I have a dream? See, Martin Luther King, he had a dream, but he had a system. He had an operation to make sure that dream will come to pass. But too many of us, nobody has taught us to kind of surround it with something. We just had a dream, and we think we're going to walk right into it. And years go by, and months go by, and then you get older, and then you start wondering, Lord, I had this dream so long ago. How come it's not happening? Am I talking to you all so far? You have to surround it with, say it again, care. Say it again, care. A dream will come. In other words, this dream will come to pass. It doesn't have to be a dream. It can be your reality if you plan and you have care around it. Now, that simply means this. You also have to be careful on the kind of words you speak about your dream. Y'all hear me? You also got to be careful on what people speak about your dream. Did you know one bad word from a critic can kill a dream? Your dreams are so fragile. It's like premature babies. You have to place them in a certain environment, and if anybody sneezes on it or anybody touch it the wrong way, the baby can die. Your dream is like that. It's coming from the spiritual realm where God has for you, and then you have to kind of care for it and surround it with the right kind of things so that dream can grow. And I think I know a little bit of what I'm talking about because I had to plow through a whole lot of stuff just to get this thing going the way it is. And obviously this is my dream, but I had to surround it with care. And I think this is one of the main things that people are just missing out. And yes, I'm going to teach you some scriptures, but if you don't surround it with care, everything that I'm going to say from this point on, it's not going to happen. You will just hear another sermon. And you know what? And Mr. Shannon was saying about how you go through, you know, your work week and you like the devil beat your head in. And that can happen for years if you don't surround your dream with, say it again, care. And I think most people are just existing through life, going to work, coming home, making dinner, getting up, taking a shower. But they don't experience the dream. And so sometimes they become critics to other people who are walking in their dreams because they didn't fulfill their own dream. They didn't surround it with care. They just had a dream and said, I'm going to do this. No prayer, no planning, no structure, no putting money aside for the dream. Nobody is feeding the dream. But the Bible says when there are a lot of words, means a fool is somewhere present. So you're either going to be a fool or you're going to be the dream catcher. I like that, the dream catcher. Woo! So the dream will come if you have care. But if you're just talking, the Bible says a fool is somewhere. What kind of people are just talking all over your dream? Because you may not be a dream catcher like you think. If you just have a whole lot of talking. Sometimes, and I say this a lot, sometimes you gotta stop talking and you gotta bust a move, but surround it with care. Y'all get it? Everybody say again, care. Go to Genesis chapter 37. Let's just park the bus in Genesis chapter 37. Can we do that? Verse 1. A dream comes when there are many cares, when there's a lot of effort, when there's a lot of planning. It has to come out of your head and go onto paper. It has to come off paper and go into your actions. It has to go off your actions and go into a strategy. And a dream will come. You're in Genesis chapter 37? Look at verse 1. The Bible says, Jacob lived in the land where his father had stayed. In other words, I'm in the place where it's normal and everybody has the same thing. I'm used to this environment. It's comfortable. This is Canaan. Now, it's going to be the promised land for the Joshua generation, but at this point, it was just regular. And it was good. It was sustainable. But if you're a dreamer, you can't just be satisfied with what's stable. Please hear me. There's going to be something about you that's saying, I got to get out of here. I'm talking about dreamers now. If you're just somebody who just liked to stay there because my father stayed here and his father stayed here, then stay there then. But don't call yourself a dreamer if you're going to just stay in one spot. Am I talking to you? I'm talking to myself at least. All right. Verse 2. This is the account of Jacob's line. Joseph was a young man of 17. He was tending the flocks of his brothers, the son of Bilhah, the sons of Zilpah, Hebrew names, his father's wives. He brought his father a bad report about them. Something about Joseph that just kind of brought a bad report. But watch this, verse 3. Now Israel loved Joseph more than any of his other sons because he had borne to him in his old age, and he made an ornate robe for him, or a coat of many colors, your Bible may say. And when his brothers saw, verse 4, when his brothers saw that their father loved him more than them, they hated him. Everybody say haters. And they could not speak a kind word to him. Now, one thing about Joseph, as you can see, is he has favor on him. And that's the first point I want to talk about. Say out loud, I'm favored. See, dreamers have favor on them. In other words, Joseph was the last one, and a lot of times You may feel like you're last in circumstances, last in life. You're the misfit. Nobody understands you. It seems like you have this favor on you, but everybody else don't see the favor that you see yourself. Am I talking to anybody? Okay, y'all said I am. I'm gonna keep talking though. Because I know that every dreamer is a misfit. Every single dreamer is a misfit. Every single dreamer is a misfit. And they also have favor on them. And yes, they may be last, they may be the one picked last, they may be the one that's acknowledged last, but they also have the favor of God on them. So they always stand out. No matter if you put them last, some kind of way they're gonna pop up to the front. And you know what? Joseph probably had like a little bit of a, you know, oh, I'm favored kind of thing. The Bible says he brought his dad a bad report. So yeah, he doesn't have balance. Sometimes dreamers don't have that common sense, forgive me. They see a dream and they go after it. Or they see things and they just kind of just don't think about it. And a lot of times it rubs people the wrong way. Are y'all still in the house? All right. So the Bible talks about that Joseph was kind of lonely a little bit. He was the only one who didn't fit in. He was the only one who saw things a certain way, but he still had favor on his life because he's a dreamer. So look at verse five. Joseph had a dream, and when he told his brothers, they hated him all the more. Verse six, he said to them, listen to this dream I had. We were binding sheaves of grain out in the field, and suddenly my sheaf rose and stood upright while your sheaves gathered around mine and bowed down to it. Verse 8, his brothers said, do you intend to reign over us? Will you actually rule over us? And they hated him all the more, watch this, because of his dream. Everybody say, because of his dream. In other words, because he's a dreamer. He didn't do anything wrong to them, but because he's a dreamer, some people will just hate you because you just dream. Because you see yourself as being above average, not that you're better than anybody, but you see yourself as being above average. And a lot of times people don't like people who like to stretch beyond what's average. Why don't you just stay in Canaan, Joseph? Why don't you just stay like everybody else? How come you have to come to me with this dream? And people will hate you because you want to believe for something more than what's around you. Your mom was like this, your dad was like this, they grew up in this neighborhood, they only made this amount of money, and you don't see yourself like that. And you mess around and tell people, I'm supposed to be better, and they will throw stones at you and hate you. And all you're trying to do is just chase after your dream, trying to surround it with care. Y'all hear me? That's what Joseph was at. Joseph was somebody who was a misfit, who didn't fit in, and all he was doing was telling his dream. And people start hating him. Look at verse 9. Then he had another dream. Everybody say another dream. You almost like get to the point and say, wait a minute. Why don't you shut up, Joseph? They already don't like you. How in the world are you gonna have another dream? But one thing I realize about dreamers can't shut up. Y'all hear me? They always reaching for something else. They always planning for something else. It's like, when is enough enough? Not for a dreamer, it's never gonna be enough. And that's where Joseph was at. Joseph was at the point where he kept dreaming. And people will start saying, you need to stop. You need to sit down. You need to do something else. You need to be average like us. But Joseph is a dreamer. And that's how dreamers operate. They can't stop. When you get done with one thing, you're gonna turn around and they're doing something else. They got another project. Everybody say dreamer. How many dreamers in here? You're never going to be satisfied. Never. You need to just go for it. Whatever that dream is, you need to go for it. And so watch this. He told his father, you know the story. His father rebuked him, talking about, he had a dream talking about the sun and the stars all bow down to me. And the father said, you think we're going to bow down to you too? But the Bible also says in verse 10 that the father kept it in his heart. In other words, some people may appear that they are not for you, but inward, they're looking at you like, you know what? That probably might happen for you because you're different. Everybody else is average. The way you're talking, it seems like, yeah, I don't want to hear that, but it might just happen for you. And that's where you want to get to the point. And sometimes people won't tell you. that they're for you, but they actually want you to succeed. Dreamers, they want you to succeed, because if you don't make it, they don't want to say, I told you so. They just thought that actually you probably can have a chance better than anybody else. If anybody got a good shot, you got a good shot at it. Y'all hear it? So watch this. Now verse 12. Now Joseph's brother had gone to graze in their father's sheep near Shechem. He told them, go, let me skip down to, he said, go and find out about them. Verse 14. So he said to them, go and see how well your father, your brothers and your flocks, and bring word back to me. Joseph arrived at Shechem. Verse 15, a man, everybody say amen. A man found him wandering in the fields and asked him, what are you looking for? That's how a lot of people are. They're at a point where they're just wandering. They're wandering around, and then somebody has to come and say, what are you looking for? You know you had a dream all this time. You had these thoughts, but you're still wandering. You're in a state where you're just wandering around. And he said, I'm looking for my brothers. And the Bible says that the man pointed. He said, I'm looking for my brothers. And verse 17, they had moved on, said the man. I heard them say, let's go to Dothan. Dothan. Now, when you look at that word Dothan, I saw it as this, two words, do then. It's spelled backwards, so a little different, but it's like do then. In other words, Dothan is the place where you stop just talking about it and you have to go and do it. Y'all hear me? Your dream, point two, is over there. That's what the guy showed up. And you know what? That's what happens when you're wandering in life. You need somebody to kind of point you in direction and say, you looking for your dream? Yes, I'm looking for my dream. Well, it's over there. But think about that. These guys who point you in the right direction, they don't tell you the details that's in Dothan. They don't tell you that you may not survive. If you go to Dothan, you may not come back to Canaan. See, the guy who points can be a preacher that points you in the right direction, can be a book, can be a life event, can be a birthday that says, are you looking for your dream still? You're wandering around looking for your dream? Yes, I am. Your dream is over there. And you have to make a decision. Am I going to just leave what's familiar, Canaan, and go to this unfamiliar place of Dothan, of do it then? Because if you go to Dothan, there's haters over there. You have a dream, but it will separate you from just thinking about it and to actually walking into it. Oh, I hope I'm talking to you all. Because people don't like to go to Dothan because it's hard. I thought it was going to be easier in Dothan. After all, I'm a dreamer and I got favor on my life. Go out there to Dothan then, because it's over there. And then they point you in the right direction. You have a decision. Am I going to chase behind this dream? Like we sang the song about chasing after, your grace is chasing after me. Are you going to chase behind that dream? Because you know where it's at. But if you don't go, you're never going to reach that dream. You're never going to have the life that you know you're supposed to be living. So build that business then. Write that book. Launch that ministry. Do the thing that's in your dream, but know that Dothan is not easy. A lot of people come limping back when they go to Dothan. Because I wish the guy would have told me, in Dothan, there's a plot, there's a pit, and there's a price. I wish he would have told me that. No, all they do is just point to you, your dream is over there. Then you go out there and get bruised. I thought it was easier than that. No, you need to wake up, dreamer. Because now, you are chasing after this thing now. That's when you start putting money behind it, not just talking about it. You start planning a strategy around it. That's, everybody say Dothan. Dothan is the place that separates you from being serious or just dreaming. It's easy and it's cheap to talk. You mess around, put some money behind it. Start planning, and then Dothan may get to a point where you may lose everything. Once Joseph went to Dothan, he didn't come back to Canaan. Y'all know the story, right? This was the last stage to go toward his dream. Now, they're going to strip you from your favor. They're going to strip you and talk about you, but you will be on the track of your dreams. So don't be thinking that, oh, Dothan is easy. All I got to do is go to the do it then. Go ahead and do it. But just know that there is a plot. Everybody say a plot. A pit and a price. Every single dream you have will have those three. But your dream will be fulfilled. But please know, you got to count the costs. I got a few notes, but I'm already flowing. All right. So I told you, if you go to Dothan, you may never come back. If you go to Dothan, you may lose the coat of favor on your life. If you go to Dothan, you may risk everything. If you've been wandering long enough, now you need to make plans necessary to actually live out this dream. That's what Joseph did. The Bible talks about that he chased behind him in verse. Let's go to verse 17 again. They moved on from here. The man answered, I heard them say, let's go to Dothan. So Joseph, watch this, went after his dream, went after that plan and found them. In other words, it's exhausting running up behind this dream. It's going to cost you a lot of money, a lot of energy. Don't think you're going to just skip like the yellow brick road and just make it there. There's going to be a lot of plots and pits and prices to pay. I hope, I pray, I am talking to every single one of you all in this room. Because I've been to Dothan a lot, and I lost a lot going to Dothan. But I went anyway. And Joseph is the same way. He didn't even think twice. He just went to Dothan, not knowing what's going to happen to him. You all know the story. I went, if I can tell you a little bit about me, I had a pretty cool position and salary in Memphis. Being a youth pastor, I could have stayed there until I retired. And God gave me that dream, said, you need to start a church called the Foundation of the World Church. And I want you to leave everything in Memphis and go to Arizona. Nobody in Arizona knew me. And I quit my job, took my boys and my wife. We drove, didn't even have a job, didn't have a place to stay. We just drove off a dream and went there. And I was humbled because I was in an unemployment line and they farting in the line and everything. And I can't get out the line because they, you know, if you get out the line, somebody's gonna take your spot. But I had to stay in the humbling place of Dothan. And I remember it that I thought I'm more anointed than this. How in the world did I end up here? Well, it's the price of your dream. And a lot of people don't want to pay that price. I'm just speaking from my own experience that when I went to Dothan, I'm thinking that all I got to do is just jump out there and God's going to provide. No, I hit those rocks, got a lot of scars and 3 years of just doing all kinds of crazy stuff and learning. But it was in Dothan. If I did not take that step, I wouldn't be where I'm at right now. And I haven't arrived, but I think I'm on my way. And I'm trying to help anybody who has a dream to recognize that, yes, your dream is over there, but it's not easy. A lot of people just like the finger. Go over there. It's your season. Yes, it is your season. But in Dothan, you're going to have to really recognize, am I called to this? Am I really called to it? Because Dothan is going to test you. Y'all get it? And so I'm almost done. I got this thing. They just learned from me. My next point is the plot, the pit, and the price. Everybody say the plot.
The plot.
The pit.
The pit.
The price.
The price.
Again, every dream has these three. So here's Joseph right here. I'm going to go to verse 18. I'm going to read 17 again. They moved on from here and they said, let's go to Dothan. So Joseph went after his brothers, this dream, and found them near Dothan. Verse 18. But, everybody say but. When they saw him at a distance, in other words, they saw him before he saw them. And sometimes the circumstances see you before you see it, and they start to plot, the Bible says. They start plotting together in verse 19. They says they plotted to kill him. Verse 19, here comes that dreamer. See, look at the mentality. Look how they see him now, the dreamer. And that's an honorable title to have, the dreamer. They said to each other, let's kill him and throw him into a pit or a cistern and say some ferocious animal had devoured him. There's always going to be ferocious animals around. There's always these plots to make sure that you don't walk into that dream. There's always going to be a lot of things that's going to cause you to think twice about, am I really called to do this dream that I really want to do? Because as you're just going on your way, on walking, mind your own business, at a distance, they are plotting to make sure that you don't reach this dream. So he says right here, verse 21, when Reuben heard this, he tried to rescue. Everybody say rescue. He tried to rescue him out of their hands. He said, let's not take his life. Don't shed blood. Let's throw him into a pit here in the wilderness, but don't lay a hand on him. Reuben said this to rescue him. Everybody say rescue. Rescue him from them and take him back to his father. In other words, there are some people, everybody's not against you. I don't want to come off as, oh, everybody's against me. Nobody wants me. No. There are some people on the other side. They may not tell you they're with you, but they're not against you either. And they tried to rescue you. He tried to rescue Joseph. There are some people that want to help you. But if you know the story, in fact, let's just read it real quick. So, verse 23. So Joseph came to his brothers. They stripped him of his robe. They took the favor off him. Verse 24. And they took him and threw him into a pit. The cistern was empty and there was no water in it. It's a dry place. Now Joseph is sitting in the pit in this dry place wondering, was this dream worth it? And a lot of times people, when you get thrown into a pit, it causes you to reflect. Wow, should I have moved my whole family across, or should I have really invested all of this money? Should I really have wrote down the plans for this? Because now I'm in a pit because of God. And all I'm trying to do is just keep up with my dream. And the Bible talks about how, I'm going to go back to Reuben. Reuben wanted to help him, but if you know the story, Reuben couldn't help him because it was too late. What am I saying? Some people really want to help you in your dream, on your dreams, but they're not in a position to help you. They may have the right heart and they really want you to succeed, but they are not called to help you. You have to go through this by yourself. And so don't fall out with people because they're not helping support your dream. All I need is $5,000, you can loan me that. No. They want to help you, but they're not called to help you. Some things you got to just get dirt underneath your own fingernails and let the pit happen, because the pit is part of your destiny. Dothan is part of your destiny when it comes to your dream. Y'all hear me? I'm talking to myself, but I'm talking to you all too. Dothan is part of every dreamer's destiny. And you can go to people who you know that can help you, and they won't be there. But it's nothing wrong with them. It just means that you're on schedule to go through this by yourself, because it's going to make you who you are. You're going to have to remember this pit experience. And so he's in a pit sitting there, and they saying, we can kill this guy if we want to, but let's just get rid of him. You all know the story. The Midianites came, right? They said, no, let's not kill him. Let's sell him. In other words, the price was 20 pieces of silver. That's a lot of money at that time. Sometimes it's going to cost you everything you have for one shot at a dream. Sometimes it's going to cost you everything. Please hear me, family. And you can't just think that, oh, a little bit here, a little bit there, and I'll walk into my dream. No, you may have to pay a high price, higher than you thought. What if by you going after your dreams, you will experience bankruptcy? Ooh, nobody wants that. Some people went after their dreams and lost their family. Some people went after their dreams and broke relationships with other people for a dream. That's a price. And Maybe that's why a lot of people don't want to walk into their dreams. The price is too high. 20 pieces of silver. I'm in a pit. I look like a fool. People start wondering about you. I wonder what happened with them. I mean, you know, when you go and pay that price for your dream, you got to risk going down to the humble place where people are just saying, well, I thought something's going to happen with them. I thought they're going to be great, but they're just fell off the face of the map. Now it seems to everybody else, you're a nobody. That's what happened with Joseph. They sold him to be a slave, right? So now it's like, what's going to happen to his dreams now? But that's a part of the process too. Don't think that something is unfair because you have all this heartache when it comes to your dream. How many dreamers I have in here? I want to give you a perspective that this dream, it will be fulfilled if you surround it with care, but you're not exempt from Dothan. You're not exempt. You have to go through like everybody else and earn your stripes for that dream. So again, write the book, do the business, buy the house. All those other dreams that you know you're supposed to have, Dothan is a part of it. And there is a plot, there is a pit, and there is a price. It's not gonna be easy, but you can do it because you have favor on your life and you surround it with care. So it's gonna happen according to the word. But it's not gonna be easy, okay? And I'm speaking again from experience that is your dream may be one of the hardest things you ever do in your whole life. That's why God gave that dream to you. So I want you all to just think of your dream right now, or just whatever it is. And you have to ask yourself the same question like Joseph did. Am I gonna just go to Dothan knowing that I may not ever return back to this stage of my life? Knowing that I may lose, you know, my father or my friends and my atmosphere and everything that I'm used to and my favorite. Am I gonna risk it all for this one dream that is so uncertain? You gotta think about that. Because if you're a true dreamer, Dothan is waiting on you. Dothan is waiting. I don't know, I feel like I just need to kind of just let that sit for a second. Dothan is waiting on you. And you're gonna go through the pit. And I said that enough. You're gonna go through the pit. Reflect on how much will it cost you to live this dream? And I'm almost done. I got a few notes. Y'all get anything out of this? All right. Oh, I like this part. I put in here, some people climb out the pit themselves. They climb out too early and they go back to Canaan. You have to wait until they pull you out the pit. Like Joseph, he stayed there until they pulled him out. When they pulled him out, yeah, it was on another level to go to Egypt. And it was painful. He got sold as a slave. But as I was studying this, I saw how people make a way to, I want to get out of this pit. I don't want this. It's too hard for me. I thought it was going to be easier than this. So they begin to climb out and then they go right back to where they were again. They never dream again. They never believe again. They stop reaching again because that pit was too painful. And so Joseph kind of just waited until the Midianites came and they paid the price. And yes, it was sad because he was taken from his father, but he was on the track to his dream. Y'all hear what I'm saying? It's gonna be a tragedy to go forward, but it's exactly what you need to be the Joseph or the dreamer that you're supposed to be. Y'all get it? Everybody say the pit? No, I'm sorry. Say the plot. The pit. The price. All right. And he had to learn a whole new way of living. Instead of just being the favorite son, he had to be the slave. He had to learn a new lifestyle and develop new working habits just so he can fund his own dream. And it's humbling, you know what I mean? It's humbling for you to kind of go down so low, since, especially when you're used to being up here, and then God takes you all the way low because it's part of your dream destiny. That's humbling. But if you can endure that and you can go through it and kind of just take it on the chin, you will come out. And when you start coming out, the Bible said the Lord was with Joseph in the prison. It was with Joseph in the palace. All of these different things that we're going to talk about next week, because he know how to endure the heartache of a dream. Okay? And so, dreamers, I know it's a short teaching today, but hopefully it was directly to what you need to hear. Because I don't want people to get discouraged because the going got tough because of your dream. Okay? It's supposed to be tough. That's why you need to surround it with care. And you need to surround it with the right people. And don't let any breath of any critic blow on your dream and kill your dream. You got to surround it. And if it doesn't mean anything to you, it's not going to mean anything to anybody else. So go for it. I say that a lot, don't I? Go for it. Say out loud, go for it.
Go for it.
Now you got to tell yourself, tell your spirit inside of you, go for it. Go to Dothan. Okay? Just feel like talking to you. Go ahead and do the fashion thing. But you got to go to Dothan, though. Okay, you got that. But listen, there is there's a plot and there's a pit and there's a price. But I think as dreamers, if you don't count the costs, you're not going to make it to the top. And so we need teachings like this to kind of help wake us up, because I think on the other side of this, it's like us, we have this mundane everyday life. And you have the key to your dream, and you see all of this other potential here, but you have to be somebody who's willing to risk it in order for you to get your dream. Okay?
Thank you for listening to Upon the Rock broadcast. If this message has been a blessing, you can help us spread the gospel by sharing this message with your friends. Also, if you're online, please be sure to contact me, either through our website at shakirministries.org or through social media. I would love to hear from you. Together, we can build a godly foundation in the lives of people. Until next time, please know that I'm praying for you, and I hope to see you on our next broadcast.